Hey everybody, Nathan Fowkes here. So, I put this image up on the blog a few weeks ago and I really appreciate the positive response that it seemed to get from everybody. So I thought I'd revisit it in the form of a step-by-step demo for you here and to throw in a little bit of audio commentary as well. So this is an image of Clark Allen, and Clark is one of those people that you really hope you have the opportunity to meet and to work with as an artist, because Clark was a colorful character from the very beginning. You know, I remember, if you don't mind a little bit of backstory about Clark, when I first started drawing him, you know, he'd sit up there during long drawing sessions and he would kind of wax eloquent about previous experiences in his life. And frankly, those experiences were so outrageous, you just had to believe that he was weaving tall tales. They might have been based on a kernel of truth, but they just had to have gotten bigger and bigger as the years passed. Well, one night I was over at Clark's house going through his collection of costumes for an upcoming painting session. Clark had an entire room of his house dedicated to his costume collection. It was amazing. And he let me take a look at his collection of photo albums before I left that night. Well, he had told stories about being on the set of One-Eyed Jacks with Marlon Brando, who directed and starred in that film, and Marlon Brando making a pass at his wife right in front of him. He told stories about touring the country with Betty Davis, and of course, Betty Davis making a pass at him during the tour. Well, as I thumbed through the photo album, there was Clark on the set of One-Eyed Jacks, his arm around Marlon Brando, his wife, who appeared as a flamenco dancer in that movie. There he was touring the country in different venues with Betty Davis and lots of other colorful locations and events and costumes. It was all true. And so Clark is one of those people who carries an expressiveness in his pose and in his costume that I hope I've caught a little bit here. This is a little bit of a less positive image of Clark, because this particular image comes right at the end when Clark didn't have much time left. He passed away a few years ago, and in this image I think he, you know, sensed and knew that his health was starting to fail, because he carried that thousand-yard stare and a forlorn expression that he hadn't necessarily carried in the past. That was the particular instance for this portrait, and I hope I've managed to capture a little bit of the sense of a man, you know, at that twilight stage. Okay, so let's take a look at the process here. I'm working on heavyweight Canson paper. It's actually a tone paper. It has a light warm gray, and the drawing is done in orange Prismacolor pencil. I know that's a little bit unusual, but I like to put down a light, warm drawing that I'm going to be able to see through my charcoal. I've made the drawing much darker here than it really is, so that you can see it clearly. I've upped the contrast. I actually do this drawing very light and delicately. So, an explanation of why this drawing is taking the approach that it is, because a lot of students get a little bit concerned about the apparent rigidity of the drawing and aren't quite sure that's the direction they want to go in their initial lay-in. Well, as often as not, I'm much more loose than this. As often as not, especially in a condensed life drawing session where there's not much time, I'll do the drawing quick and loose and try and just get a simple gesture and shape. And that serves me just fine. But when I'm doing a demonstration where I want to carefully explore with students the variations in the form, or when I feel like I need to come in with a lot of confidence in my charcoal stroke and be very direct, I'll go ahead and take the extra time for a drawing that looks like this one. What I'm looking for, whether it's quick and loose or a tight drawing, is the big long lines of the form, the big simple shapes of the form, the accurate proportions And I'm also trying to get a sense of planes and overlapping lines in there to create a sense of depth, to create the illusion of life onto this flat two-dimensional sheet of paper. So that's the goal for the initial lay-in. And then I come in and hit what I consider to be important landmarks. Again, the long lines of the pose, the big simple shapes, and trying to find the most important landmarks that I don't want to lose over the course of the drawing, which lets me ready for the big blocking stage, which tends to look like this. And the reason that I'm blocking it in this particular way is because it's critical at every stage of your drawing to always be reaching for a clear, simple statement. And what could be simpler than stating what's in light and what's in shadow? My next step is to now work into those forms. And so what I'm doing is I'm grabbing the tones that I've put in the shadows and in the darks, and I'm taking them and I'm wrapping them around the direction of the form, creating these halftone lights and leaving the paper for the highlights. And guys, I'm finger painting for the most part at this stage. There's no reason anyone else has to use their fingers, but it's the way I like to do it. I like the directness and accuracy of it, and I like to use other tools as well. I'll use a blending stump, I'll use tissue paper to push and pull, but largely finger painting at this stage. But this gives me a sense of the sculptural forms and the hard and the soft edges, which leads me and leaves me ready to take this to a finish. So in this final stage, I'm using new pastels. In this case, it's an ivory new pastel that I'm using for the hair. And this, I feel, helps me create an illusion of life because I have the charcoal and the paper for the tones of the light and shadow of the skin, and then I'm able to use the different texture of the pastel in the whites of the hair, carefully wrapping my strokes around the direction of the hair to create the illusion of that three-dimensional effect on the page. And a comment about this approach, let's zoom into this a little bit. I've mentioned several times as I've talked to you guys about reaching for a clear, simple statement in your image. And so to illustrate that point, I've laid a digital filter over top of this image. This is a noise reduction filter that smooths out the details and the textures and leaves nothing more than the sculptural values of light and shadow and the hard and soft edges. Every step of the way, I feel strongly that you have to reach to hold on to this simple sculptural statement, because every single one of us has a powerful tendency to do exactly the opposite, and there's a good reason for that. Whenever our eyes and our mind look, we want to pull as much information as possible out of what we're looking at. It makes perfect sense. It's survival. It's our ability to successfully navigate our way through the world. And so this thing that lets us survive in the real world actually is the thing that often kills us in the life drawing classroom, because we cannot let ourselves get caught up in the details and the contrasts and lose the clear, simple, sculptural statement. So you can put as much detail work as you want into your image and as much as time allows for your life drawing or painting session, but you have to make absolutely sure that those details do not distract from that clear, simple statement of light and shadow. In the same way that we have a tendency to misinterpret the values, we also have the same tendency to misinterpret the shape. So, back to the original drawing here, if we look at, say, point A here and point B here, it's nearly a perfectly straight line between the two, and yet almost all beginners misinterpret and do not see that straight line. They actually believe they're seeing something like this. Once again, because we most strongly notice the variations and tend to accidentally exaggerate those things. And worse, we might even get a compliment for it. Someone might think that we're trying to caricature the head. My day job is in animation, and I'm here to tell you some of the best caricature artists are animators and storyboard artists, because I've seen them do caricatures where they've taken as few as 4 or 5 lines and done a caricature of someone where everyone who knows that person can actually recognize them from the simple caricature. That's a caricature that has artistic intent. What we're seeing here is not caricaturing because it's an accident. There is no intent. And in fact, it's an uncomfortable busyness added on top of something that does not need it. Okay, so if we zoom all the way in, we can look at that long, simple line. You see the simple wrapping of the brow. Here's one big long line around the form here. Here's one big long sweeping turn all the way around the form. Those big simple long lines are emphasized for clarity. Okay, so I hope this overview has been helpful for you. Hopefully we can do it again sometime, so good luck with your drawing.